About PPE. Thank you, Lindsay. And we always talk about PPE as one of those topics that are very commonly overlooked. So that's why I put PPE, the most overlooked safety issue in the workplace, because in my practice as a consultant, when I go out there and I visit your work sites, I see that some of these issues are glaring to me and they're right there. And for some reason or another, many times it has to do with, you know, shortage in time. We don't have a lot of time to really assess the workplace and truly make decisions based on that information. So when I, when you guys hire me for those walkthroughs, for those random inspections, or to help you with some Cal OSHA inspection or a document you received or a complaint you received, I look at how your managers are making decisions about personal protective equipment. And I realize many times that no one has taken the time to analyze what's needed for that particular task, job, or department. So that's why today I want to talk about the most commonly safety-related violations that have to do with personal protective equipment. Also, there's a new rule that is a new proposed rule that OSHA, federal OSHA, is coming up with just for the construction side of the equation. I want to mention it, although California is stricter and it has been stricter and has included some of the changes that federal OSHA is now going to include. So that's going to be interesting for you as well. And then number three is understanding the required PPE certification form, which is the one that is missing most of the time. This certification form is not required for the construction sites. Nevertheless, it does, it's an interesting thing because California OSHA does a loop and it goes back to saying, okay, we want to require everything as in subchapter 7 for general industry. So my advice is, because it's required in general industry, let's go ahead and do one also for the construction, the form itself. The actual hazard assessment is required for the construction industry, but it doesn't tell you to have a form. And the interesting thing that I see with this is that how are you going to prove that you did an assessment if you do not have it documented? So although the assessment is a requirement, the actual form, the certification form, is a good thing to do also for your construction sites. We're going to talk about some of the issues that I've seen in the workplace. And I want to bring up this most cited, top most cited, or most frequently cited by federal OSHA, which include every single state. But as you know, this is very valuable information as to what they're looking for and what they see that is most commonly out there. California OSHA has some variations just because we have other regulations. For example, we have the injury and illness prevention program requirement. And so that's the top most cited here in California, the lack of an efficient program. But for example, when we talk about personal protective equipment nationwide, the most cited, the most frequently cited is always respirators. And so I want to bring it to the table because I have seen this in my regular practice, and it's not only for medical settings. So when I see here at the top of your screen, 500 different most frequently cited regarding respirators and the lack of medical evaluation, it doesn't have to do with healthcare settings. So let me clear that up first and foremost. The medical evaluation is an actual part of the process when you assign a respirator to an employee. So that means that in order for you to allow them to wear a respirator, you got to send them to the doctor. When I say send them to the doctor, an actual form, which is a medical evaluation where some questions are asked that have to do with their health status of the employee, is what is answered. And you're going to send that to your industrial physician or your occupational doctors, and they're going to review that evaluation, those questions that are being asked of the employee who is going to be wearing that piece of equipment. And that's when the doctor makes a decision as to whether or not they want to bring him or her into the office to do maybe spirometry or any other test to check how the lungs are working, because they need to make a determination whether or not this person is fit to wear a mask. They're going to be wearing something on their faces, and their lungs are going to be acting as the power to that equipment because it's going to be drawing in that air and filtering it through the mask and through the filtering material. So that medical evaluation becomes the most cited. I've seen it in my practice as well. Needless to say, not just healthcare settings. I've visited a couple of manufacturing companies lately, that have spraying booths, where, you know, the employee is going to be either spraying glue or paint or whatever they're spraying in the booth, and they have to be wearing their personal protective equipment, including that chemical suit or overalls. And they're going to be wearing, you know, their face protection, and they're going to be wearing a dust mask or a half elastomeric piece, right? And when you make that determination, there has to be that medical evaluation and a respiratory protection program in place. That's why it's number one, because you see also another setting I visited not too long ago, manufacturing of beer. So when you have half elastomeric pieces, half masks that go on the face of the workers, and you see the workers with beards, you're thinking, maybe we're lacking here a full program, because these workers do not know that the beard will not allow a nice fit. And when I say it, it's more a seal, I'm sorry, because the fit gets measured once a year, but the seal is done every day. You have to make sure that that piece of rubber, or if it's a dust mask, it's a filter piece, has to seal, form a nice seal against the face, right? And the beard will not allow for that to occur. So we have second most cited, the fit testing, which needs to occur once a year to make sure that the make and model of that mask that you're providing for that worker continues to fit appropriately, because our faces change, we gain weight, we lose weight, etc. And then we get the lack of an actual respiratory protection program as the third most cited. And this is all related to personal protective equipment. And then the next one would be the verification of a workplace hazard assessment. So in California, we do have a form, a certification that the workplace was assessed and that you made a determination as to which pieces of personal protective equipment they need based on that assessment. Last but not least, still under the general requirements, you have to assess the workplace. So the verification would be the document to verify that you did do this, and assessing it, making sure that it takes place. It doesn't have to be once a year, doesn't have to be once a month. It has to do with the fact of the tasks, the activities. And if you've done this once, and those activities and the tasks and the chemicals and the layout and the job activities or operations in that particular department do not change, then you do not have to assess again. So the assessment comes about with any changes, deficiencies, or even incidents at the department that has been previously assessed. Okay, cool. What else? We have here also most frequently cited series, and this is for just the fiscal year of 2022. And then you can see that at the top is machine guarding, hazard communication, has to do with the use of chemicals. Then again, respirators, because we have an actual regulation that requires that you have a respiratory protection program in place if you assign respirators to your workers. We will talk a little bit about the voluntary use. That's slightly different, but this has to do with the issue that there is a need for a respirator, either because you have spray booths, or because you're in a healthcare setting, or because you're dealing with silica dust. And silica dust, we're going to have a full class. I'm going to ask Lindsay to tell us when that full class will be. But I will do a free webinar for the month of, like we do every month. It's August, right? Sometimes I don't even know what month I'm living in. I'm sure it happens to you guys. But for September, so next month, we're going to do silica dust for the free webinar. Reason being, there's been more cases of silica dust and accelerated silicosis in the countertop industry. So we'll be tackling that. I always talk about it because this has been an issue since 2010, when we did have those engineered stone countertops. They look gorgeous, they're beautiful, but they are not like the rock that we find in the rock mining industry, which is natural rock. These are engineered, made by men, and they look gorgeous. They look like natural rock, but the concentration of crystalline silica is much higher, and the problems derived from it, such as accelerated silicosis, are bringing people to have very serious health issues and even die very soon at a very young age because they can't breathe. So I do have someone chatting here with me. Feel free to chat. Oh, thank you, Lindsay. So she's giving us some information regarding the silica dust exposure prevention class, which is going to be held over 2 days because it's quite a lengthy set of regulations. There's two regulations for the construction industry and the general industry. That's what we will visit in August 30 and 31st. So make sure you do take that class. It's going to be in depth. You are invited. And also, please forward these links so that your coworkers start speaking the same language with you. So you can see there again, PPE in the form of respirators. And then lockout, tagout, of course, we've seen that and we've talked about it in one of those, in this monthly series, forklifts, competency training. I do always ask about that when I'm there doing my random inspections for you guys. Again, respirators, employer establishing a written program. We talked about that. SDS readily accessible. And this one, believe it or not, the last one on your screen is also related to the PPE because the lack of safety data sheets for all the chemicals that your workers use. And for those of you that do not know what an SDS is, that's a document that the manufacturer of your chemicals, being your oils, lubricating oils, alcohol, acetone, they send to you with the purpose of safety issues. So you know how to handle the chemical, how to store the chemical, how to clean up a spill, a small spill, a large spill, safety measures, personal protective equipment. So the actual need to have safety data sheets readily available is huge, even for the topic of personal protective equipment. All right, and we keep going. And in real life, we have to know that respiratory protection is one of the most overlooked PPE items and issues of non-compliance. Why? Because I realize that when I go out there, just because of the pictures that I'm going to show you, we lack that assessment in writing. And we call that a certification of assessment. So that's what I'm going to show you right now. The second thing that you see on your screen has to do with safety glasses and safety goggles. So I put it here in real life because these are some of the things I see in my practice when I go out there and I walk your facilities. So I see guys not wearing safety glasses and I ask the question, why are they not using their safety glasses? And I get different answers. One, it could be because, you know, they get all foggy or they're uncomfortable or it's very hot and I'm going to sweat. They're going to stay very muggy and dirty. And because we work out in the field, it's just not practical, or we forget them in the truck and the vehicle is parked over there. There's many, many reasons why the workers, when I show up at the workplaces randomly, are not wearing them. I'm going to show you some pictures as well. But this is something that you need to strengthen. There's too many, and I should have shown you the statistics, but the eye injuries are high, not just for a state, but federally. We have a lot of incidents at the workplace that are related to eye and face injuries. So you don't want anybody with a bad eye or losing their sight because of our lack of enforcement because of our safety glasses policy. Now, when I say this, mind you, I do have insurance carriers requesting that we put together policies where the use of safety glasses is enforced. And when we say enforced, that means they want to see policies where you are saying if you do not wear your safety glasses or if you're found in non-compliance or we are in your department and you're not wearing your safety glasses, you're going to get a written warning or you're going to get suspended or, you know, the hierarchy of what you're doing. So gloves, I also see when I go out there that people are not wearing gloves when they need to, or they're cutting the fingers out, or they're wearing something different that they buy on their own. These are good questions to ask from your workers. Why are you wearing that? And why do you like that glove better than the one we provide you? And you're going to be fascinated by the answers. You know, well, the ones they give us don't allow good dexterity, and I just can't grab very well. And I need to reach all the little parts in my tool in my tool belt when I'm doing the installation. So they're cutting the fingertips. So it does prompt you to look into what kind of gloves can you give to them. Are they cut resistant? Are they what is it that you're providing them? And is it something that they need, or do they need more protection? One thing that I advise in regards to the use of gloves, there's a lot of companies that will take the time to talk to you and ask what tasks are being done that necessitate the use of gloves. And they will go over recommending the appropriate type of glove, and then they will send you samples for free for your workers or a group of workers to try, and then that you can do the order of many of those boxes. The next one that I've seen is the adequate use of PPE according to the safety data sheet, which I already said why is so important. Maybe if your safety data sheets are not available, workers are not going to know how to use that chemical. And another thing that is key is when you have huge vats or totes with chemicals, oil, etc., you have to have spill kits, right? So in case there is an actual spill. And you have to have training prior to the spills occurring, because you have to know if this is going to be, is there, there's the possibility of a small spill or a large spill. And do you necessitate a trained team in hazardous, what we call hazwoper, so that you have different levels of response. But when it's a small spill, you have to train people. You have to allow for them to see that safety data sheet. You have to show them that spill kit, and that there's those spill kits come with personal protective equipment inside. So you need to take a look at whether or not it fits the worker, it's adequate. And this conversation really comes about if you take the moment to go over to where your chemicals are, your totes, your containers, your drums. Where are your spill kits? Have we trained these people? So that should be a big to-do for you as we finish today's session. The next one would be adequate footwear in warehouses. When I go out there and do these random visits, I do see the guys wearing regular tennis shoes, cloth top, and or if I am there to do a visit and the human resources person is with me doing the walkthrough, he or she are wearing regular nice dress shoes, which shouldn't be allowed. So it should be a strong policy. And if you're the one drafting the policy, why are you walking the floor with me wearing regular tennis shoes or even open toe sandals, right? So I've seen that a lot. I continue to see it. I make notes. I put it on my report, and you even see and you go, oops, it's me not in compliance. So if workers, let me remind you, if workers do not see you setting the example, it's not going to happen. So PPE written policies, I realize that many times people are not wearing the right type of PPE because there's no policy to enforce it. That's one of the things I said with some of the insurance carriers, or in order to provide coverage to my client, they will require a written policy and the appropriate footwear or safety glasses, for example, eyewear or policies in place and an enforcement policy. How do you, what are the actual consequences, disciplinary action for supervisors and for regular employees, because they want to see that you do hold supervisors to a higher standard, meaning the actual disciplinary action for supervisors is stronger than for regular employees. Lack of hazard assessment in order to determine what to provide. That's the last one that I want to bring to your attention. I do see that you provide with a PPE. So I want to commend you for that. You do give them gloves, hard hats, dust masks, face masks, face shields, gloves, and et cetera. But you fail to actually have a reason why you provided that. And when we fail to have that, an actual assessment, the analysis never took place. And if the analysis never took place, we might be providing with the wrong piece of equipment. So let me show you some pictures, all right? This is one of those forms that I sent to you, my employer, to let you know what happened there, the temperature, the time, the location of what I did. This was for a landscape client. And I took a look at the crew as they were working, right? And for personal protective equipment, this is an example of how I have all the categories laid out, whether or not this was excellent, good, poor, or non-applicable. For safety glasses, I was visiting a crew of three people, probably. Yeah, three. And then it says one worker was wearing his own prescription glasses, not wearing safety goggles, not able to correct issues since there were no more goggles available in the vehicle. Right? So these are good notes. You have to start asking, how come we should provide a box? And then when I asked why there wasn't more safety glasses in place, in case they broke, got scratched, etc., the reason was because they had a very tight inventory of these things. So you don't really want that. I mean, there's nothing in the regulation that says, hey, I have to pedal back a little bit. There is something in the regulation that says that you have to provide it at all times because it's needed for the hazards present, right? But there's nothing in the regulation that says that you have to give them 10 or 20 or a whole box. But you have to make it practical so they are never at the job site without the safety glasses. The next thing is a second worker was not wearing safety glasses due to heavy sweating that would drip onto the glasses. So we did take the picture and we made some more recommendations. And the issue here is there are some safety glasses that have, or even hard hats, if the worker is wearing a hard hat, that come with a sweatband integrated to the hard hat. Very cool stuff. I mean, there's PPE out there that can be very costly, expensive, and very cool. But you have to come up with solutions. At least for safety glasses, you have to give them different options. It's not in the regulation that you have to put up out there 5 models and different types for them to pick. But is it recommended? Yes, because then it is encouraging the worker to wear what he likes, what is comfortable, and what works. Some of them have like a little top lip that allows for debris to be stopped, even sweat. So this is something that you want to look into it to get better compliance. The glove was excellent. The guys were wearing their gloves, either leather for working with abrasive material, and they were wearing some of those anti-puncture gloves when they were working with shrubbery, etc. Hearing protection worn while operating the lawnmower, I could observe that. The shoes were observed in all workers, but I did, they were all having good non-slip work shoes. There's no need for the actual steel toes, so just non-slip good work shoes or work boots, and I saw that everyone was doing that. Goggles, the same thing with safety glasses. So the use of goggles, workers need to know the difference. Once again, this goes back to your assessment, right? If there's an issue of debris or splashes that will be injurious to the eye, you may need goggles. And if it's going to be hot and they're going to be sweaty, goggles with vents, right? Also, the issue of prescription glasses is huge. I see this all the time where workers, when I ask them, where are your safety glasses? Well, you know, it's just that I cannot wear them because I have my own prescription glasses. Plus, my own prescription glasses work. You have to show them a video. So if you're doing software-based training, also put in there a video where there's so many videos nowadays available where if you wear your prescription glasses and there's debris jumping and breaking the glass or the whatever material your prescription glasses are made of, the pieces of your own prescription glasses will get into your eye and cause more damage than the actual debris or dust that is in the environment. So they need to know this because they think that their own prescription glasses are protecting them. The job of the employer is to enforce this. So if they have no way of getting immediately before coming to a job site, prescription safety glasses, because they're available, but they are expensive, and you do not have a program or a policy where you have an allowance. Mind you, all these personal protective pieces of equipment are to be paid by the employer, but there are some exceptions. And prescription safety glasses are one of those because it's an item that is very personal, very customized, and they can take 2, 3, 4, 5 jobs, however many jobs they have a day or a week. Same thing with steel toe boots. It's a very personal item. And if you allow them to take it off site, then you do not have to pay for it. An allowance is always great. It really encourages people. It creates more loyalty, etc. But I do have an issue with the prescription glasses, as you can tell. It's a huge issue. So much that I'm spending quite a bit of time talking about it. And it's because when you are saying that worker is exposed to debris or the hazard of splashes, and they are not wearing safety glasses or safety goggles accordingly, you are going to end up with those eye injuries. And who is to blame? Not the worker for not wearing it, but you for not enforcing it historically in the past and right now, and making the people aware of it, of the policy, of the disciplinary action, and letting them know that this is happening, that people are being sent back home for not bringing all of their PPE, if you've assigned them with a PPE bag, etc. But this one is a huge one. So as you can tell, we do this, and we go out there. The lack of that assessment, the actually going to your different departments or looking at the different activities that your workers do, and I have 2 pictures here on the screen, results in no written personal protective equipment policy. So it doesn't say, what should I be wearing when I show up at your workplaces or at your field sites or at your warehouse? it just, lack of assessment results in no PPE policy. So I'm going to wear whatever I can, however I can. There's a cap under the hard hat of this worker. So as he is getting down from the truck, the cap is tilting and the hard hat is coming off. So those are some of the issues that are present at the job site. There's no eye protection. And as they're dumping debris, they're exposed to a lot of this matter jumping back at them. None of them were wearing safety glasses. Why? And then some of them are like, you know what? Yeah. And in one occasion, when I dropped this, as we are going to the landfill and just emptying whatever we have because we have to get rid of it, some chemicals splashed back at me. And there's also equipment and construction trucks and whatever all around. So there's a lot of dust and we don't wear it because there is no policy. So no eye protection, and the shoes, not appropriate footwear because you're just wearing kind of a cloth top shoe that is not really indicated for this type of work. But why? Because there's a lack of assessment. So it results in that. More of this in real life. I go to your job sites and I see someone operating the table. So mind you, he did not have hearing protection on, but when he saw me, he quickly went and grabbed his earmuffs. He has a dust mask. So the lack of assessment results in, you know, he's wearing shorts. When I say shorts, that means what type of attire, even the clothing that your workers are wearing, a uniform, shorts are really, I'm not a fan of shorts. And of course, it just depends on what they're doing. And a lot of field workers, if they're not working with any power tools, it might be something that it's okay to wear. But I am not a fan of allowing anyone at any job site with shorts. But if you don't have a policy, even the clothing that they wear while at work is inappropriate, right? Because you want to protect the skin of the worker. You want to make sure they do have a nice, sturdy uniform. And of course, from having pants, even more so, what are they doing? Are they exposed to debris? In this case, there's debris. So there's glue, there's material that I don't want him to get on his skin. So shorts shouldn't be allowed at the workplace, especially when they are operating tools. Inadequate hearing or no hearing protection. And that has to do also with the fact that you're not doing that assessment. I have that picture on your screen of the NIOSH app. So you go to the cdc.gov, NIOSH noise, and then you're going to see the actual app that you can download, which allows you to do some noise measurements in the general area and gives you an idea of how loud it is, because the action level is 85 decibels. And that means if you're yelling at workers or we're screaming at each other when we're trying to communicate in this area of work, it is too loud. It's way over 85 decibels of noise. You might have to take a look into, like we always do with PPE, the hierarchy of controls. I should have added this to the slides, the hierarchy of controls. If I don't, when I send you the slides finishing this class, I'm going to send you the link for the hierarchy of controls. Because remember, it's not just giving him the earmuffs, it's looking into engineering controls, elimination of the hazard. How can we eliminate the noise? Or can we eliminate the process or the machine that is making the noise? So we do safety differently. We don't start with the provision of personal protective equipment. We start with the question, can we eliminate this hazard? And that's how OSHA wants us to see the provision of PPE. First and foremost, how can we eliminate and eliminate the hazard if it's not possible by isolation of the hazard, moving it away off-site, enclosures, partitions, or removing the workers? Then how can we reduce it? And we look into administrative controls like rotation of personnel, restricted access, authorized personnel only. Those are administrative controls. And then we move on to the provision of personal protective equipment, which has to do with, okay, so this is how much we did to reduce the hazard. And now we still are going to have the occasional debris or splashes, and we want to provide with safety glasses, safety goggles, face shields, etc. When you do the assessment, it really prompts you to take a look at what PPE is available out there in the market, and you will be surprised as to how much of it is, and then get into that balance or medium point where you're not spending too much, but giving them what they need and also providing options so that they actually wear it. Also, the footwear, I am not sure that these are appropriate steel-toe boots because this is a manufacturing plant. You can see metal resting right over the wall. which I don't know, I'm not sure even that's appropriate storage either because of the opportunity of them toppling over. If anything is going to fall on your feet and it's going to cross your toes, you've got to have steel toe shoes, right? And if it's a matter of, you know, they have to do this many hours of work, make it lighter, look into composite or aluminum, whatever fits the job they're doing and the task they are doing. All right. This is something that I brought up because of that issue of noise, right? So there is a lot of most commonly cited or frequently cited regarding noise. So many times we provide them with earplugs, earmuffs, because there's a lot of noise that it is above the actual level of 85 or even the permissible exposure limit of 90 decibels in a time-weighted average, mind you. And you're maybe thinking, what is that? What is she talking about? I'm talking about, and Lindsay, can you do me a favor? I don't have my timer next to me. Can you tell me the time?
It is 11:34.
Okay, good, good, good. I'm doing good then. I thought, man, it might be 12 already and I'm speaking like a parrot. Guys, if you have any questions, please chat with me. It is important that we go over this issues and we look at it with the eyes of real life. That's why I bring my pictures over. That's why I talk to you about what I see. But sometimes you do have questions and you bring them to the table depending on the topic we are discussing. So you can chat or raise your hand or unmute yourself. Or if you think of something, jot it down and then email me your questions. Lindsay will make sure that they are forwarded, or in the slideshow, I also put my information. So like I said, occupational noise. Hearing conservation program, the lack of it, because there's a requirement once you are exposing workers to noise that is above the action level, if you do not do the analysis where you have to actually bring in a team, an audiologist to check out. And mind you, you have to do these in hierarchy of controls first, right? Engineering controls, et cetera, to reduce the noise. And if you're still exposing them above the action level and even to above the permissible exposure limit of 90 decibels and of time-weighted average, you have to have something in writing that says, how are you going to reduce? When are you going to train? Who is it going to be included in your program, in your hearing conservation program? And the annual testing that you're going to do to make sure they did not lose hearing, right? And it has to do with PPE, because I don't want you to just provide hearing protection without knowing why, right? And some of you do it preventatively. And so that's A-okay, especially if you're under the 85 decibels, the action level for the time-weighted average. If you're not sure, though, and you're getting these readings, high readings in your NIOSH app, talk to a professional, call us, and let us know whether or not you need us to go out there and take these measurements for you. And make sure that we take them during the noisiest times of the day and calculate your time-weighted average exposure and see whether or not you need to put that hearing conservation program in place. More on those inspection photos, for example, and I didn't put all the pictures here, but when you have a yard and let's say, for example, you have big mountains of gravel that people are shoveling, that's an issue of exposure to silica. You will not know what to provide to them if you don't do your inspections, right? So take those pictures. A lot of the times, if something looks iffy and you don't know what you're looking at, just taking that picture and then later on asking what was happening here, why were you doing this, will bring about the issue of, hey, maybe we need to do this, maybe we need to do that. But yes, even shoveling gravel brings the issue of exposure to silica dust. Here, all workers wearing safety vests, especially in yards, or even in warehouses where you have uniforms maybe, or people just can't be working very early in the morning or really late, then you would not have clear visibility and you would want them to be wearing safety vests. Safety vests, I put them as part of the personal protective equipment, and that is important. Give me a quick second. Okay, so the workers' safety vests, I said, need to be included as part of your PPE. Interestingly enough, I observed sometimes visitors, right? So as I am there doing your walkthroughs, doing your random visits, I see visitors. And I see that the visitors do not comply with your PPE policies. They need to be included. They need to have, you have to have sets and even hooks or walls nicely organized with PPE that you provide for visitors. Dust clouds, you know, other methods. Once again, if you can do wet methods to minimize the dust, then you don't have to put people on all of these respirators and things. Engineering controls. Remember, the hierarchy of controls is important in order to avoid even the use of personal protective equipment. I go there, more pictures. So this is all about real life instances. Here, I look at the footwear, work boots of the people I am visiting. And if I see torn, worn and torn shoes, I will bring it to the attention of the supervisor or foreman. And the worker needs to go home. The worker needs to have good working shoes. And hopefully, this is why I say having a policy where you have an allowance for work boots is very important, because it does encourage the worker to continue to bring good shoes to the workplace. Talk to them about what happens, especially in this case, they were working with lawnmowers, and you have to have good work boots because you do not want those shoes to be trapped under the blades or have an issue where you're crushed by some of the tools. Especially with landscape, you move a lot of heavy objects. So you want good work boots, and then you make the analysis whether or not steel toe is recommended. For some of the workers that have to kneel a lot, steel work boots wouldn't be recommended because it would hurt the tips of their toes. Then we move on to fall protection. So I see a lot of issues. This is another one of those topics for analysis under the hierarchy of controls, because you want to take a look at the hazard and you want to really ask yourself, do I really need to put my workers in fall protection or fall arrest systems, right? And if that's the case, in this case, these are Tourette trucks that come with a way to tie off, then you do have to have a program for fall prevention. And, you know, the picture that I took there is because the harnesses, the lanyards, and the fall protection equipment are being left anywhere and everywhere. So they should have a designated place, especially for harnesses and all the fall protection equipment. It should be away from chemicals, liquids, dust, anything that could create an issue of deterioration of the material or staining of the material or even absorption of chemicals of the materials and the straps. In case of a fall, the actual harness or the lanyards or any parts of the personal protective or fall arrest system will not work appropriately if they are not stored appropriately, right? They also will get very dirty, and dust makes for the faster deterioration of your equipment. So here I found this website also in regards to PPE for paint spray, and you can visit this later on. It was really nice to see how they really laid it out for the reasons why this is needed, right? And if it's paint that you're spraying, the VOCs, the vapor organic compounds that create serious issues for the health of those workers, and it could be short-term, it could be long-term. But as you can see here, he's wearing a dust mask. And in this case, the use of a dust mask is not voluntary, okay? So the reason why it's not voluntary is because the exposure to a chemical, in this case paint, requires that the worker wears it. When we provide dust masks, like for the issues of nuisance dust, like for example at the yard, those pictures that I showed you, and some workers, you know, would like to use that mask just because it gets dusty once in a while, that could be on a voluntary basis. So what you do is you provide the masks, you do a training session where you tell them it's on a voluntary basis because it's not required that you put it on. But in the case of a paint spray, it is required that they put it on because you're trying to avoid a health issue from taking place or from occurring. You don't want them with irritation in their throats. You want them with lung problems or obstructive pulmonary disease, which is something that occurs because of workers exposed to the aerosols when spray painting or glue spray, et cetera. So each chemical brings about the issue of different health situations. So make sure that if you are requiring the employee to wear this dust mask, and this is brought about with dust mask only, the moment you give them a different respirator, such as an elastomeric half mask or full mask, then you have to have a program in place. So if you have workers that go to the store and bring those to the workplace, because you can find them very easily in Home Depot, and they, ooh, this is cool. Look, they say it's good for when I spray paint, and they are putting this elastomeric pieces, half masks. You cannot allow that unless there's an analysis made and whether or not this is going to be required. And for a spray paint, of course, it's a requirement, but they need to be fit tested. You have to have a respiratory protection program in place, annual fit testing and training on how to use it, clean it, store it. In the case of dust masks, they are one use and disposable. But in the case of elastomeric, they need to be cleaned properly and stored properly so that the filters do not continue to filter everything that's in the air. So hanging them in a hook on the wall, not appropriate. What types? There's many types in. So once you do your assessment, you're gonna find out that you may need eye and face protection, fall protection, foot protection, hand and general skin protection, head protection, hearing protection, leg protection, personal flotation devices, respiratory protection, torso general. So the whole body can be in need for protection if the task calls for it. So doing these assessments should be between that supervisor and the person that knows that the task, that knows the task or the operations, because they're great at telling you, well, we need because of this, we need because of that. And if it's just one thing that you're dealing with, for example, gloves, and I'm going to go back to gloves for a moment. In one of my walkthroughs, I found out manufacturing plant that they had the first aid log and they had a list of several cuts, so nicks and cuts that were occurring at a certain department. So I made the suggestion that they look into why. So even though those are not incidents, they're just wearing, putting a Band-Aid on. But because there are several nicks and cuts, that you make an actual analysis as to whether or not a glove is needed and what level of cut resistance, right? So this is how you get about doing safety in real life. Take a look at those logs. Don't ignore as you're walking through. Really look at what's there and why it's there. Ask questions. Take pictures. And many of those pictures are going to be trashed, but a lot of them will actually prompt you to make the analysis. And in this case, it prompted us to make the analysis to why this many nicks and cuts. Can we improve this form to include the department? And now take a look at whether or not they're wearing gloves, what kind of cut resistance, resistant glove. And then I like to involve those people in the selection of the gloves, because you can make a selection. Oh, they need a number two. You know, you can call the reps and they'll tell you, oh, for this task, they'll need this type of glove and they'll send it to you. But you're not the one doing the job. You're not the one getting nicked and cut every day. So ask them and ask them what kind of glove, or you will see that some of them are actually buying for themselves gloves. Why do they like it? Look at the actual markings on it. What kind of cut resistance do they have or do they wear? And then make the choice, the decision, and provide them, because it is a requirement that you do make the assessment, provide it, and pay for it. Ah, so now we get into the requirements. The actual regulation is Title 8, California Code of Regulations 3380, and I highlighted some of the most important ones. They have to be worn according to manufacturer's instructions. OSHA is huge with that. Maintain in a safe sanitary condition. They have to fit. So this is where California goes beyond federal OSHA. Protectors shall be of such design, fit, and durability as to provide adequate protection. So they need to fit well, and it tells they shall be reasonably comfortable. So you have human beings of different shapes and sizes. So you should have PPE of different shapes and sizes. And if you want them to wear it, give them the cool stuff. They'll wear it. The cool Oakley safety glasses. The two pairs, mind you, for the sun, and clear ones. They will love you for it, but you will get this compliance. So there are things that we can do to go beyond what the requirement is about. Perform a hazard assessment. So right there, that's the wording in the regulation. And then I promised to tell you a little bit about this new proposed rulemaking. It has to do with the fact that the actual construction regulation, and we every time we say 1926, we're talking about construction regulations federally at a federal level. I want you to know that it's quite similar to the one in California, but it doesn't have those requirements for fit, comfort, etc. So when you get to say fit and comfort, which is not added here, The actual proposed rulemaking is saying, you know what, we have more women in construction, and this is something geared towards the construction sites. This picture is from the OSHA.gov website, because there most of the PPE is designed for bigger faces for men, and so, but there are smaller pieces of personal protective equipment that we have to actually provide to those workers in the construction industry so that they're not just having to pick from all these pieces of personal protective equipment that doesn't fit. It is open for comment until September 18th so that employers can actually tell OSHA, nope, you're wrong. It will be very costly for me because A, B, and Z, whatever you want to say. So there is the link for you to actually analyze the new, the notice of proposed rulemaking, that it would actually change and help avoid more injuries and what's happening, especially in construction, especially because we have more women in the workforce. We do have guides, the construction guides here in California. We have two. The reason why you see the Spanish screenshot that I took, but I put both of the links there, is because interestingly enough, if you look at the guide in English, it's kind of in disarray. I don't know. There's something there that they didn't do right. The PDF file for the pocket guide, and I'm talking about the pocket guide. If you've never seen it, it's one of the most amazing documents for construction work to help you be compliant with safety. I use it constantly. And the 2022 pocket guide in English, the online version is not, I think it's not well organized. I can't, like, it's missing some parts. And the Spanish one is not. So it goes into PPE needs to be provided, and it goes into eye and face protection, that it is obligatory whenever there's an inherent risk to injury to the eyes, et cetera, or even for welding, et cetera, or flying particles, et cetera. So that's 3382. The requirement is 3382. And then it goes into requirement for 3385, foot protection. And then requirement for hand protection, 3384. And then it goes into hard hat requirements also in the next page. So the guide will guide you through PPE requirements in the construction industry for California workers. Why do the hazard assessment? I think at this point, and Lindsay, please do let me know when we're 5 minutes to 12. But at this point in our session today, I think it's important to know that it is the way to go. The hazard assessment is the way to go, because otherwise you're making decisions just eyeballing it. I think you need safety glasses. But there's no reason why I'm just going out there in the field talking to people. I don't care. You know, I'm all about safety. You put on those safety glasses because I said so. The assessment is needed. CalOSHA's rule requires you to do one, so you have to do it federally. Like I said, they do tell you, or in construction, they say to do an assessment, but they don't require the form. You will see that I have a form here that I put together, but there is a Oregon OSHA guide with the actual forms, and you can use it too. Oregon OSHA has great e-tools and documents that you can use. If you know the rules in California, you can actually use them accordingly. The hazard assessment, Title 8, Code of Regulations 3380F1. You have to assess it. And then upon that assessment, select the PPE, right? And then communicate that selection to your employees and make sure that it properly fits. Take in account comfort, because it's in the regulation. So this is something I put together for one of my clients. I take a look at this, and the requirement for training and the discussion with workers after I've done my assessment is to tell the workers when PPE is necessary, what type of PPE is necessary, how to properly put it on, take it off, adjust it, wear it, the limitations of the PPE, the proper care and maintenance, and the useful life and disposal of PPE. Those 6 points on your screen are so crucial, because then if you do not discuss this when you are handing them a piece of personal protective equipment, you have issues where the worker does not know, for example, that a dust mask is not going to protect them against paint VOCs, right? When they're spraying, for example. Certain cartridges are not made for that. Or, for example, they don't know how long a hard hat should be out in service. Or they don't know, for example, that they should not write with a Sharpie their name on the straps of their harness. Things like that, because they're not, you're not going one through six, one by one with them. So in this case, for example, working around shrubbery, bushes, branches, and plants with large and stiff thorns that could injure your eyes, penetrate clothing, scratch, or puncture your skin, constant kneeling. So we go out there, we analyze the task, and then we are going to list the hazards, and then we're going to list the controls, how we're going to control them, and then the PPE that we're going to provide. That's how you want to do that written analysis. And then the certification has to have a certain wording. The actual form needs to say that this is a certification form of assessment of for personal protective equipment. It has to identify the document as a certification of a certification of hazard assessment. Yes, and the hard hats do have an expiration date as well. Thank you, Gloria. That is very, very important. When you do this 1 through 6, you can discuss the proper care, maintenance, useful life. So when you get to number 6 on a hard hat, you can tell them how to look for that mark inside the hard hat, which is in the form of a little clock type of thing. And then you can also tell them how to care for them. You can wash those things, right, with soap and water and leave them to dry. Those 1 through 6 get discussed for each piece of personal protective equipment that they get to wear. So wonderful. Thank you, Gloria. Great point. That written certification then has to say certification that the hazard assessment occurred, the date. Here is the personal protective equipment by the Oregon OSHA. They do have a sample assessment. And now my practical experience says the following. Number one.
Sorry, Alba, you have 5 minutes till 12.
Thank you so much. You're awesome. So we start by evaluating the entire workplace. We say, you know, these are the departments. We draft the policies per department. Then we take a look at the tasks in those departments. We take a look at job safety analysis documents. Like I said, those allow you to divide that task into the steps, the actual hazards, the controls, and the PPE you're going to give, right? And with that document, with a job safety analysis, you can go ahead and certify that you analyze the workplace and you determine what type of PPE is being selected for that particular task. So the analysis of tasks will give you a list of PPE that you need to provide, but also by department, you can create policies or draft policies that say such and such department, the use of hearing protection is mandatory, for example. So even visitors, right, that go there need to be provided with a set of earplugs, earmuffs, whatever you have decided it is, taken into account the actual noise cancellation rating or the actual density of the foam in the earplugs. But that's what you provide even for visitors. So go by department, start with the departments, taking a look in general, what is needed for the department, draft your policy, then move on to by tasks so that you can list the steps of those tasks, the actual hazards, the controls, and the PPE. Don't forget that when you have field work, you have an actual different dynamic. It's not a brick and mortar setting. It's not something that is going to happen all the time. So you want to have a form that allows you to daily change and do a PPE hazard assessment. This was done for a tree trimming job site where actually the field work changes. The trees they actually have to trim differ from a palm tree to, you know, sycamore trees. Palm trees will be needing a very different type of personal protective equipment depending on how they're approaching the job. Are they going to use a scissor lift? Are they going to actually climb the palm trees, et cetera? So you have to have forms that allow for the foreman who is assessing and surveying to make this assessment because the actual task is so different from on a day-to-day basis. For example, here, when you have this hard hats, if you have a type one class C type of helmet, it has vents, it'll keep them cool, but it is a conductive type of helmet. So they cannot be near any high voltage lines. And this is important because when you do this PPE hazard assessment certification, which allows someone to actually sign that they did the assessment, which is required in the regulation, you actually make that decision whether or not the type of helmet used at that site is the adequate or not adequate. So one conductive, one non-conductive, depending on the work they're doing, right? Training requirements, we talked about this. It was on the form right there with a picture for the landscaping issues. I also put it as a grid, English and Spanish, so you get it now with my slides. You'll get a copy of this so you can tweak it and use it. But I like doing it as a table or a grid, because then the workers can write down and it gives me some ideas as to the information they're missing. If they don't know, oh, I don't know this. I don't know, for example, how long should I be wearing my harness, for how long the life of it, right? And they should know that if they actually take a fall while wearing their equipment, their fall protection equipment, that equipment is to be rendered not usable again because it went through a fall. That's some of the limitations that they need to know. Many times you haven't discussed it because you're not using forms like this. If we don't use forms, we forget. We tend to forget. Checklist. That's why checklist is so important. Did we or did we not fulfill our objectives? So I wanted to make sure I talked to you about some of the most common safety violations and things that I see out there. I tried to bring it to, so that it's practical and means something to you. I want to make sure that I mention always, this is a safety update webinar. So if I see something new, bring it to the table. And then last but not least, I wanted you to know that the certification is required for general industry. I do like these forms also for the construction side of the equation because you're required to do that assessment. Guys, have a fantastic weekend. If you think of any questions, if you think of anything that you didn't get to ask today, we want to answer it for you. Don't forget that we have the incident investigation class coming up, I think. It's also a two-day class. We go in depth to give you tools to investigate those incidents at your workplace. And then the silica exposure, and then our free webinar for next month, which will also give you a quick review of what we see during our in-depth class.
Thank you so much, Alba, and thank you, everyone. Please fill out the evaluations after this class and let us know if you'd like a certificate. But we'll see you See you next month. Thank you so much, Alba. Have a good weekend.
I'll see you in a couple of days, Lindsay. I think we have our classes this week as well. So thank you. Thank you for all your help. Thank you, everyone.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.